Good morning to all. Please come down and be seated. We'd like to welcome you this morning to our first worship service. And as we did announce, this first worship will be live streamed. The link was sent out to the congregation, so it is available to you all. So this morning, Benedict will be bringing the lesson to us, and Reg will be directing us at the table, and then Benedict will also lead us in the singing this morning. But we would like to this morning just welcome Nelson Makonuhini. He was baptized actually in February already. Brother, we certainly want to welcome you. I mean, we do apologize for not welcoming you earlier. But unfortunately, we can't hug you this morning. But we certainly want you to feel welcome with us this morning. We also like to thank Craig and his team. Sorry, what was your name?
Johan,
for coming to set up for us. What we're looking at, because I suspect that the government's going to announce today that they're going to have a total lockdown, because I heard them talking this morning. But have no fear, we will be doing a service. And then also the Wednesday night Bible study, the idea is to go and set up at Al's house, and he can do the lesson from there. And he can actually do 1, 2, 3 lessons ahead of time, and then always just send out the link on that, but he can do it in his own time. So welcome to all. Let's have a prayer. We would also just like to just remind you that after the service, we're going to finish at 2:15. Those of you who have been here, please just leave the building speedily, because we need to make provision. We only allowed 100 people at a time in the assembly on the property. Let's go to our Father in prayer, and then we'll start. And most gracious and Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning, Father, and we just want to praise you, Father, for your love and your care, and that we have someone like you, Father, we can always turn to, Father. We're mindful, Father, of this disease that's going around, Father, and we pray that you would protect us all, Father, and we know, Father, that you are there for us. We're mindful also of those people, Father, that continually need us to pray for them and to bring them before you, Father, and we pray that you would supply their needs to them, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Please turn in your songbooks to hymn number 503, 503, 503.
Swiftly we're turning life's daily pages. Swiftly the hours are changing to years. How are we using God's golden moments? Shall we reap glory? Shall we reap tears? Into our hands the gospel is given. Into our hands is given the light. Haste, let us carry God's precious message, guiding the erring back to the right. Millions are groping without the gospel. Quickly they'll reach eternity's night. Shall we sit idly as they rush onward? Haste, let us hold up Christ the true light. Into our hands the gospel is given. Into our hands is given the light. Haste, let us carry God's precious message, guiding the erring back to the right. Souls that are precious, souls that are dying, while we rejoice, our sins are forgiven. Day Did he not also die for these lost ones? Then let us point the way unto him. Into our hands the gospel is given. Into our hands is given the light. Haste, let us carry God's precious message, guiding the erring back to the right.
In preparation for the Lord's Supper, would you be turning to number 105? 105, that is in preparation for the Lord's Supper. And before Lodge comes, we're going to demonstrate how we are going to partake of the Lord's Supper this morning, because we have the pre-packaged Lord's Supper elements with us right here. We just want to do a short demonstration and tell you how it will work. It's very simple, very, very basic. Interesting, the number in our songbooks on the opposite page, number 106, is called Fear Not, Little Flock, which is going to tie in with our lesson later on, which where Jesus says, it is I, do not be afraid. 105.
When we meet in sweet communion, where the feast divine is spread, hearts are brought in closer union, while partaking of the bread. Precious feast, all else surpassing, wondrous love for you and me. While we feast, Christ gently whispers, do this in my memory. God so loved, what wondrous measure, loved and gave the best of him, bought us with that matchless treasure, yea, for us his life was given. Precious feast, all else surpassing, wondrous love for you and me. While we feast, Christ gently whispers, do this in my memory. Feast divine, all else surpassing, precious blood for you and me. While we sup, Christ gently whispers, do this in my memory. Precious feast, all else surpassing, wondrous love for you and me. While we feast, Christ gently whispers, do this in my memory.
Amen. So if you have received one of these pre-packed communion, the communion symbols, you'll notice that you have the fruit of the vine in the little glass below. And right on the top, you have a little wafer. So there are two plastic seals, and the first plastic seal is a clear one. The first one is a clear one, so don't pull the purple one back yet. Just take hold of the clear one, and when you pull that one off, you'll see that there is a little wafer underneath that first one. There's a little wafer. And so what will happen is Brother Ledge will lead our minds at the Lord's table in the things that he has prepared, and then after he has prayed for the bread, we will then remove that little wafer, and then we will partake of the of that emblem of the bread, symbolizing the body of Jesus, reminding us of his body. And then, of course, after the prayer for the fruit of the vine, you'll then have the second little seal, which is this purple one that I have hold of between my two fingers. You'll then pull that one back, and then after the prayer for the fruit of the vine, we will consume the grape juice. And after we have done that, please just hold on to these things. Don't put it back into the receptacle or into the tray. Just hold it in your hand, and we can dispose of it as we leave the building. So I think that's plain and simple. That's easy enough. So Brother Ledge, would you please come and lead our minds in what you have prepared. Thank you, my brother.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This morning we really are amongst a cloud of witnesses. For those of you that have got your soul sanitizers handy, the Bible, I'd like to do a reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians 15. Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which you also stand, by which you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believe in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I first received, what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. Wise words from Paul to the church at Corinth that were in a time of crisis. Wise words to us today that are in a time of crisis, but we will rise above it. We must just never let, like the church at Corinth, like Paul was warning them, that we will lose sight of the goal, and never lose that sense of gratitude towards what Jesus has done for us. And remember, of first importance is to break bread and to serve the Lord. And that's why we are here this morning, come what may.
Amen.
Shall we give thanks for the body of Christ? Father, we are extremely grateful to be here this morning. And Father, we thank you that we've got an anchor to hold on no matter what. And Father, although the storms rage, Father, we know we are in your ark of salvation. And we know we've been saved by the blood of Christ. At this time, we thank you for the body which was bruised for us. Father, for the price that Jesus paid for the physical pain. And we thank you for the bread that represents his body. Bless each person that partakes of it. In Jesus' name, amen. You will now partake. Thank you. We will now give thanks for the blood of Christ.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning, O Lord, that we could gather today. Father, we thank you for your blood that cleansed us, O Father, from our iniquities. We thank you for your blood that saved us, O Lord. Amen. We know, O Father, that you suffered many afflictions, O Lord, because of our sins. Father, we thank you that we can gather here today in the midst of all the challenges that we have and partake of the Lord's Supper. We thank you, Lord, that we can remember you, O Father, even when, O Lord, the world is currently in fear of the virus that's going around, O Lord. Father, we know that in you we may not fear, but we may remain strong because we know that you are with us. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We now have the opportunity for those that wish to give back to the Lord in a monetary manner as they have prospered. That concludes the table and the giving. Thank you. We'll now have the preacher giving the chair.
We're going to be singing the first and last of hymn number 15. But before we do that, let's give thanks for the contribution. Thank you, Father in heaven, for the opportunity that we had to give back to you, Father. Thank you, Lord, that you've given us so much. And help us, Father, even during this time, that we would not be afraid, Father, of giving to you, but that, Father, we give to the one who holds everything in the hollow of his hand. And so, Father, bless each one that gave. Bless those, Father, that give online, Father, by EFT, and those, Father, that still intend to give. Thank you, Father, that you gave your one and only Son. And, Father, that when we look at what our Savior gave, that we too, Father, will give our lives for you and not just our income. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen. Number 15, to God be the glory.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Amen. Our lesson this morning is titled, It Is I, Do Not Be Afraid. Our text is taken from Matthew chapter 14, verses 25 through 27. Let's read the text together. It says, and in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. Verse 26 says, but when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, it is a ghost. And they cried out in fear. Verse 27 says, but immediately Jesus spoke to them saying, take heart, it is I, do not be afraid. I would like to start off by asking a question. What does one say when you are confronted with a global health threat like the one we are facing now? The initial response might be curiosity. When we hear the word, when we first heard the word COVID-19 or the coronavirus, we didn't know what it was. But that eventually progressed to fear and then outright panic, which is what we have today. We've seen how people have gone about buying up whole shelves, whole bins of produce and food and that kind of thing. The hand sanitizer, as we know, is nowhere to be found. And of course, even masks and prices have risen accordingly. According to a man by the name of Dr. Carl Albrecht, he says there are five types of fears, but I'm only going to focus on the one that is relevant to what we are experiencing right now, and that one is extinction. And Dr. Carl Albrecht says that extinction is, this fear of extinction is the fear of annihilation, of ceasing to exist. He says this is more than just a fear of death, or how we might die, but it strikes at the very heart of our fear that we would simply no longer be. Examples of triggers include fear of the dark, fear of flying, fear of heights, and fear of fatal diseases like the one that the world is experiencing right now. Dr. Albrecht calls it existential anxiety. This is similar to the panicky feeling we feel when we are standing on the top of a tall building and we are looking down to the ground below. Now, over 145 times in our Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, God says, "Do not be afraid." There are several other verses that are similar to this, but the specific phrase, "Do not be afraid," which is actually an imperative, meaning it's actually a command. When Jesus says to his disciples, "Do not be afraid," it is not a suggestion, but rather it is a command. Listen to what God said to Abraham in Genesis 15, verse 1. "Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward." To Jacob, God says in Genesis chapter 46, verse 3, "I am God, the God of your father. Do not be afraid to go down to Egypt, for I will make you into a great nation there." Joseph reassured his fearful brothers after his father had died. If you remember the account in Genesis chapter 50, when Jacob dies, Joseph's brothers think that now he's going to get us for everything that we have done to him. And then that memorable verse in verse 20 of Genesis 50, where Joseph says, "Am I in the place of God? Whatever you did, you meant it for evil, but God intended it for good, to bring about the saving of many lives." Then in verse 21, he says, "So then, don't be afraid, I will provide for you and for your children." Instead of killing them physically, Joseph killed them with kindness. In Exodus chapter 14, verse 13, Moses answered the people who thought that the Egyptians would kill them after they were, while they were pursuing them, having hastily fled from Egypt. And Moses answered the people saying, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance that the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians that you see today, you will never see again." God instructed Joshua, "Have I not commanded you?" Notice there, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and be courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." Joshua chapter 1 and verse 9. The psalmist says, "When I am afraid, I will put my trust in you, in God whose word I praise. In God I trust and I am not afraid. What can mere mortals do to me?" Psalm 56, verses 3 through 4. I love Psalm 27, verse 1 as well, where David says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the refuge or the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" Then in our text in Matthew chapter 14, verses 25 through 27, we find that the very thing that the disciples were afraid of, which was the sea, Jesus was walking upon. The very thing that they were afraid of was at the feet of Jesus. They thought he was a ghost until he said, "It is I, do not be afraid." When we look at the original wording there in the original language in the Greek, it literally means, "I am I." And this is Jesus saying that he is God. That was the title that God introduced himself by when he spoke to Moses at the burning bush in the book of Exodus. God said, "I am." And Jesus, several times in the scriptures, notably in the book of John, he would say things like, "I am the bread of life. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the good shepherd. I am the door for the sheep." Over and over, stating that he is God in the flesh, that he is deity. I am I. Let's briefly look at what lessons may be learned from this account. Number one, the disciples were in the middle of their difficulty. We are smack bang in the middle of this global threat, this global challenge called COVID-19. We're right in the middle of it. Some countries are slowly recovering from it, like China. There are stories over the internet that most of the Chinese that were infected by COVID-19 have recovered. And the Chinese are picking up the pieces and moving on. And so will the rest of the world. However, we are probably in the middle of the crisis right now. But notice that the disciples in the text were in the middle of their crisis. They were in the middle of the sea. They were straining at the oars, verse 24 says of Matthew 14, because the wind was contrary. The wind was against them. And very often we might feel that life is against us. I remember that during the week, my son Zach, something happened. I think he stubbed his toe on one of the chairs in the kitchen or something. And he said something like this. He said, "Why is life against me?" And I looked at this little boy and I thought, my son, if only you know what is still lying ahead for you. If only you know that several times during your life, you're going to be saying those words. Many people have felt that way. And there might be people that feel that way right now. Why is life against me? Sometimes people might even take that a step further and say, why is God against me? Job felt that way, remember? And Job sought an audience with God that he could reason with God and ask God why God was doing this to him. And Job didn't realize that Satan was the architect of his destruction at the time, but that Satan was limited in what he could do. We know that life, beloved, will have its troubles and trials, some worse than others. We are in the middle of something so fearful right now, and people are straining at the oars of life. People are straining. Listen to the words of Jesus in John chapter 16, verse 33. Jesus has been preparing his disciples for his imminent departure, and they were afraid. They were afraid of what would come their way. They were afraid of how would we handle life without Jesus. And Jesus says in John 16, 33, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace." Jesus says then to them that in this world you will have trouble. Our Lord Jesus did not hide the fine print away from us. He didn't tell us that if you become a follower of mine, if you obey the gospel, all your troubles will suddenly melt away into obscurity. Jesus did not say that. He told us troublesome times will come. He says, but be of good cheer. Or let your heart be encouraged. I have overcome the world. And I think one could put in brackets there, for you. Christ has overcome the world for us. As I was sitting there and led our minds briefly in the thoughts that he prepared around the Lord's table, it was as if focus just came back to my mind. Focus just came back to my heart as we sat and partook of the emblem, reminding us rather of the body of Christ that hung on the cruel cross. The emblem reminding us of his blood that he shed for us. And in so doing, Jesus took care of the biggest problem that we could ever have in life. Remember in Philippians chapter 1 verse 21, when the apostle Paul was wrestling with this thought of either going to be with God, which is better by far, or remaining on earth to be of better service to the church. He says, "For to me to live is Christ and to die is gain." And he says, it is better for me to die, because Paul knew what was waiting for him up in heaven. He had been allowed to look up into the third heaven where God dwells. And of course, he was not allowed to repeat what he had seen there, because he says that it was unlawful to do so. For many people, it might not just be the struggle of coping with the effects of the coronavirus. I spoke to a lady in Cape Town this week who's going through a very, very bitter, acrimonious and painful divorce. Her husband has had both of his legs amputated, and the parents of this is now her parents-in-law, her husband's parents, have ganged up against this woman who had a good job at one time, who's got a good pension of over 2 million rand coming to her, and the husband now is trying to secure his future by divorcing her and claiming half of this woman's financial package. And she's going through a bitter time. She's not well herself. Very, very difficult time. One of the negative things that has happened is that her son has chosen to walk away from the family and embrace a life of homosexuality. Very, very bitter pill for her to swallow. And so there are people struggling with major, major challenges. Some people's businesses have been bankrupted. I think the global write-off now stands at over $3 trillion. And as someone has said in Afrikaans, ek kan nie eers so ver tel nie. I can't count that far. $3 trillion. It's a massive, massive amount. Airlines, the American airlines are expecting or hoping or praying for or pleading with the US government that they would get an $850 billion bailout. Another large sum of money. For some, it will be cancer. Some people are living with cancer. And in fact, just a side note that I read on the internet, someone was commenting on the economic crisis related to COVID-19. And he said, this crisis will bring about an economic meltdown that will make the 2009 recession look like a Sunday school picnic. If we thought 2009 was bad, this is going to be so much worse. Number two, Jesus came to them at the darkest time of the night. By this time, it was around 3 o'clock in the morning, which was the fourth watch of the night, the start of the fourth watch. They must have been exhausted and frightened. Remember, they had been straining at the oars. They were not sailing or using an outboard motor to get across the Sea of Galilee. They were using oars. They were rowing. I don't know if you've ever spent some time in a rowboat rowing. If you're not familiar with rowing, it is a very, very tiring exercise. And when the wind is contrary and the waves are lashing your boat, it makes it even that much harder. To top it off, it was at the darkest time of the night. It was the time of the night when most of us would be resting in our beds and sleeping. And these men were straining at the oars. They were exhausted. They were frightened. And I'm going to tell you a little bit more later on why they thought, why they were so frightened. The Jews thought that the Sea of Galilee, that below the Sea of Galilee, that it was the realm of the dead. They thought that the dead people, when people died there, the spirits of the dead would go down to the bottom of the Sea of Galilee. So can you imagine their fear? It's dark, the wind is howling, and they're not getting anywhere by rowing. And they're thinking that if they perish, if they die, they're going to sink to the bottom of the realm of the dead where the spirits of the dead lie. And so this is possibly why they were so afraid. Here's a quick question for us this morning. How often has Jesus not come to you and I during our darkest hour? Do you remember the last time that you thought this is the end? I've had several such occasions when I thought that, oh man, there's going to be no deliverance for me right now. And guess what? In the darkest hour, seemingly at the last minute, Christ would come through every single time. Jesus will come to us in our darkest hour. Number three, this is our last point, and then we'll close after this. Jesus encourages them even in the storm. While they were petrified, the Savior pacified them. Listen to John's account in John 6:19. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, that's about 6 or 7 kilometers, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were frightened. We find, though, that in Matthew 14:27, the Savior pacifies these petrified disciples and tells them, I am I. It is I. Do not be afraid. It has often been said that God does not calm the storm sometimes, but that God calms His child even in the midst of the storm. God is able to calm us and give us His peace. I remember Philippians 4, 6 and 7, where the Apostle Paul says do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses knowledge, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Meaning that sometimes the problem might not go away, but God can give you His peace, even in the midst of a very, very difficult time. And we know that Paul had difficult times. He had difficult trials. This shows the omnipotence of our Lord Jesus Christ. John 6:20 is a parallel account where He says the same thing. It is I, do not be afraid. When we read Job 9 verse 8, Psalm 93 verses 3 and 4, Psalm 89, 7 through 9, Psalm 107, 29, Matthew 8, 26, we see these things and several scriptures revealing this omnipotence of God. Listen to Job 9 verse 8. He alone made the skies and He walks on the ocean waves. When I read this verse yesterday, I thought of Jesus. This was pointing to Jesus. He alone made the skies and he walks on the ocean waves, the easy to read version says. Psalm 93 verses 3 and 4 says, "The ocean depths raise their voice. O Lord, they raise their voice and roar." And I think this refers to the wind that drives these waves. They roar. Verse 4 of Psalm 93 says, "The Lord rules supreme in heaven, greater than the roar of the ocean, more powerful than the waves of the sea." Listen to Psalm 89, verses 8 through 9. "O Lord, God of hosts, who is mighty as you are? O Lord, with your faithfulness all around you, you rule the raging of the sea. When its waves rise, you still them." Nothing is beyond the control of our Lord Jesus Christ. Everything is at his feet. He has total control over the elements, and he has demonstrated that so often to us. Listen to the words in Psalm 107, verse 29. Psalm 107, verse 20. I'm going to pick up in verse 25. Listen carefully to these words that the psalmist uses. "For he commanded and raised the stormy wind, which lifted up the waves of the sea." Verse 26, "They mounted up to heaven. They went down to the depths. Their courage melted away in their evil plight." Verse 27, "They reeled and staggered like drunken men and were at their wits' end." Verse 28, "Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He made the storm be still, and the waves of the sea were stilled." Another version says they were hushed. Let's take a look at Matthew 8, 26. "And he said to them," this is Jesus, "why are you afraid, O you of little faith? Then he rose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm." Of course, that passage referring to Jesus being in the boat, in the stern, in the back of the boat, with his head on a pillow. He was asleep and the storm came up. And the disciples thought that Jesus didn't care and that the boat was going to drown. What they didn't realize, that the very one who created all of these things was in the very boat that they were in. How can their boat sink when Jesus is in the boat? There will be a great calm after this storm as well. This too shall pass. So in conclusion, I want to tell you quickly about a story of Horatio Spafford. Horatio Spafford, if you're not familiar with this man, he penned a song called "It Is Well With My Soul." Remember that song? "It Is Well With My Soul." And when you read up this man's life story, you'll find that Horatio Spafford, who lived in the second half of the 19th century, that's around about 1850 to 1870 odd, and what happened was Horatio Spafford was a wealthy businessman. He was a lawyer and a senior partner in a law firm. He also was a real estate magnate. He was a wealthy property owner. And there was a huge fire, I think, in 1876 in Chicago. And of course, back then, the buildings were all made of wood and the sidewalks down the streets were all made of timber. And this fire ripped through Chicago. And Mr. Spafford lost all of his properties, including his own business. And so, in one night, everything that he owned was wiped out. And then because he had friends in the UK, he decided to send his wife and his four daughters. In fact, they were all going to travel together over the ocean to the UK. But because some business thing came up, he had to remain behind in Chicago. So he sent his wife and their four daughters ahead to the UK. Halfway over the Atlantic Ocean, the French ship that was taking them across collided with another vessel and sank within 12 minutes. However, Mrs. Spafford was able to hold on to some debris, some driftwood, and she was picked up by another vessel and she was saved and she found her way to Liverpool eventually after she was rescued. Mr. Spafford then went across and they wrote a letter to friends of theirs in another part of the UK saying that their four girls died in, were drowned in the storm, in this this collision on the ocean when the ship went down. But he wrote the words, "All is well." And eventually from that letter, and from that phrase, "All is well," he wrote the hymn, "It Is Well With My Soul." When they came back to Chicago after 3 years in the UK, his wife fell pregnant with a boy, and that boy, however, only lived to be 5 years old. And he died of scarlet fever back then. Another blow against this couple, against this man who wrote this beautiful song that we still have today and we still sing today. It is well with my soul. I want to close with Psalm 91, just the last two verses, verses 14 through 16. In these three verses, God makes nine promises. And I've condensed them in this way. God says to the person who loves him, God says, because he or she has set his love on me, God says, I will do the following. I will deliver him. I will protect him. I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him. I will honor him. I will grant him long life. And I will, after that, God says, I will show him my salvation. Several precious promises that God has given to us. And I like the part where he says, I will rescue. Jesus rescued his disciples. Jesus has rescued us from sin and death. God says, I will honor them. He has honored us by placing us in his family, the church of our Lord Jesus Christ. God says, I will grant that person a long life. And God says, after that, I will show him or her my salvation. Precious, precious promises. So I want to leave you with these words this morning. And thank you for coming out this morning. Thank you for your time and attention. Thank you to our camera crew that has sacrificed their time to be with us this morning. Thank you, Johan and Craig, so that we could have this this live link and so that our brethren at home can join us and be with us in spirit, if not in body. So God bless you. Have a wonderful day. If you have not had the Lord's Supper yet, we do have the emblems up here. You can still partake of the Lord's Supper. And then, of course, if you are staying for the second service, those that have just come in, you'll probably have to do that. But those that have been here for the first service, if you would please, then after the hymn, if you would immediately vacate the building. Number 243, let's stand and sing, and we'll have a prayer and we'll be dismissed. So, yes. If you need the prayers of the saints, if you need the prayers of the congregation, please come as we stand and sing the song. If you need to be baptized, we can do that for you as well. 243, first and last.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. To a land where joy shall never end, I'll fly away.
Standing for the prayer, and then we'll be dismissed.
I'm going to be calling on Morgan to come lead us in the closing prayer, please, Morgan. Thanks to Benedict for bringing the lesson to us this morning, and thanks to Ledge, who directed us at the table, and also Ben for leading us in the singing. Morgan, and then we'll be dismissed. The evening assembly will take place as normal this evening.
Please pray with me. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you. We've been blessed this morning. We've had the opportunity to come sing songs of praise and to partake in the Lord's Supper. It is human nature, Father, that we forget and that we are afraid. But this morning, Father, we thank you for your word. We've been reminded, we've been encouraged, we've been comforted, that there is nothing to fear because you are there with us. You fight our battles, some of which we don't even know, Father, and you intervene. We thank you. And as we leave, pray that we will not be oblivious to the dangers of this disease that's going around, but that we will have no fear in that, because we know that you are there, Father, and you protect us all the time. We pray for the economy, we pray for many jobs that are at stake, Father, that this storm shall come to pass soon. Bless us as we leave here until we meet again. We ask this through the mighty name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.